You're now listening to Sound Talent Media. Check out more shows at soundtalentmedia.com.
Hey, do you have an idea for a podcast but don't know where to start? Or do you have an already existing podcast that you want to take to the next level? Well, check out weknowpodcasting.com. From concept development to theme music to editing to logos, weknowpodcasting.com is a one-stop shop for all things pod. Don't hesitate to hit us up. We're very nice. Few bands have ever been helped more by a music video than OK Go. They had faith in their own music when their record label didn't, and they took advantage of internet virality to launch their career. Unique, eye-catching videos continue to be their thing, but the choreographed treadmill routine of Here It Goes Again will forever be the legacy of the band among people who only know them in passing. Is it worth going the extra mile to listen to more of their music, though? Stay tuned to find out.
One hit is all you need to make the money guaranteed, and you can live off royalties forever.
And it makes me wonder, is it just a wonder, or is it one hit thunder?
So Dave, you're the host of the Maximum Mediocrity podcast, and I gotta ask, is that why you picked OK Go today?
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm just kidding. I think actually they're a really good band. But, you know, what made you choose this OK Go, Here It Goes Again song today? You a fan?
Yes, I am a fan. And my fandom started with this video. Right. I did, and this song. I didn't even know that it was like a big deal. I never realized that it was like a one-hit wonder competitor until this podcast. I just love, there's something I love about people just doing stuff by themselves, like without a lot of big money behind it. I think this video really shows that, and the video that I think is completely indistinguishable from the song at this point.
Right. Does the music video overshadow the song? Because of course I remember the music video. It made an impression on everybody, but it took me today going back and watching the video again to be like, okay, yeah, I kind of remember the song too. But it is a recognizable song, but this might be the first band I would think this about where their videos, it's amazing that this was their one like mainstream hit, because they've made so many amazing music videos. That's become their thing.
Yeah.
And the music is pretty good.
So it's this weird thing, right? Like, OK Go kind of was the first viral music video that I can think of, because this was predating YouTube when Here It Goes Again like started to blow up, or it was the very early stages of YouTube, because the A Million Ways music video was not available on YouTube originally. It was like some other video streaming site, the video that came out before this one. But yeah, on the one hand, OK Go kind of led to this whole thing of like doing these big crazy music videos on YouTube. But I think it was also like 10 years before Billboard started counting YouTube views as like things that you would register towards the amount of streams and the amount of radio play and stuff. So it's like if the Rube Goldberg music video, say, came out in 2019, that would probably, just based on its views, probably would have been a top 10 hit based on how many people were watching that video all in the same week that it dropped. But since this was before Billboard would count that, it means nothing. Like, it was like a video that people watched like something like 50 million times that like means nothing on their Billboard standing or their charting history.
Yeah. Well, I mean, we're obviously going to talk about music videos a lot in this episode. But Dave, do you like this song? What do you think about this song? What are your thoughts?
I actually really like this song, and I think that's what makes the video have so much success and why that it stuck around and why it was such a big deal, is because the song does stand on its own. I never even knew, I'm going to admit, it wasn't until doing research for this that I actually knew what the song was about. I thought, yeah. Could you guess, like, do you guys want to guess what you think it's about just before, like, digging into the lyrics?
You know what? I never thought about it. I thought of it as... I don't mean this in a bad way, really, but I thought of it as like kind of throwaway generic lyrics that were catchy to sing. I didn't know there was like some sort of deep meaning to this song. But tell me, enlighten me.
I always thought that the song was about, like, getting through it. You know, it was about picking yourself up. Here it goes again, but we're going to get through it. I thought it was kind of an anthem to the everyman. But actually, it's a song about falling in love for a one-night stand.
Well, and there's... I think OK Go doesn't get a lot of credit sometimes for their lyrical content. And I want to talk about real quick before this song. I want to talk about something in their history before this song, because there's a key part to this that I think makes a lot of sense with everything else about OK Go before we even analyze these lyrics. So, Chris, I'm not sure how much you researched about the history of OK Go, but I predict that by the end of this episode, you are going to be a huge fan of OK Go's creative output and their creative drive.
I already am. And by the way, Matt, before you get into that, for people who are listening right now, there might be people out there being like, why do you guys keep talking about the music video? Well, for anyone who might be unsure about that, it's a music video where it's just a single camera setup, probably cost nothing to make minus having 6 treadmills in the room, whether they could have filmed it at a gym, who knows. But the effort that was put in to the choreography of the way they dance on the treadmills is amazing.
Okay.
I could see that being months of work put into that. It's impressive. It's all one shot. So, of course, it was one of the first viral music videos in the era of, like, sharing music videos that I could remember. They had one before this that was just a dance routine,
yeah,
I think.
So we're going to get into this, because there's so much to unpack before Here It Goes Again even happens. So the origins of this band date back to the lead singer and bassist being 11 years old meeting at an art camp. And their name is from when they were 11 years old at this art camp. They had an art teacher who was always stoned. And the way that he would let them know it was time to draw was he would go, okay, go. And that would be the sign that these 10-year-olds could start drawing. Even though they lived in completely different cities, since they were 11, they would send mixtapes to each other in the mail of the music that they were listening to. And that's like what brought them together in musical styles. And once they both graduated high school, they moved to Chicago to live together and get a band built. It was 7 years of them exchanging musical ideas before they ever formed a band. And hit the ground running. Like, from everything I read, it was like, these dudes fucking hustled. So the first year in Chicago as a band, they were able to open up for Elliott Smith, Sloan, and the Promise Ring, and built such a strong presence that Ira Glass personally asked them to be the house band for This American Life.
Wow.
All in their first year. Through all of that, they got an opportunity to tour with They Might Be Giants. I think that their relationship with They Might Be Giants is the most crucial piece of the puzzle of everything that happens with OK Go since, because I think that is a band that, while they don't sound like They Might Be Giants, I can see them being the biggest musical influence on.
I can hear that influence. I can hear it in their music.
They get signed to Capitol Records. They release their debut album, and they have this single, Get Over It. And I remember hearing Get It Over It. I remember watching it on MTV2. It was one of my favorite songs at that particular year in 2002. It's a great song. Sounds nothing like Here It Goes Again. But through that, the label put them on tour with Phantom Planet, Superdrag, The Donnas, and Fountains of Wayne, all bands that you can kind of hear a little bit of that influence in their sound as well.
Yep.
And the song was featured in various, like, NFL and hockey games that came out that year, but it made no impact in the United States. So they put out this second album called Oh No. From the beginning, they were like, Here It Goes Again is the single. And the label disagreed with them. The label's like, that is not the single. So the label financed 3 big budget music videos that did absolutely nothing. Here comes this dancing video that you're talking about, The A Million Ways. So the lead singer's sister is a famous Hollywood choreographer who went on to direct, like, the Pitch Perfect movies and the Step Up movies. So she choreographed this dance for them out back. But what they did was that their guitarist, Andy Ross, who's like a tech genius, sat down and he invented, designed, and programmed a web app that would allow people to listen to the song A Million Ways. And if they shared it with their friends, it would exchange it with free iTunes download codes.
Wow.
So they go out to the backyard, they do this dance choreography, and it becomes the most downloaded video at the time with 9 million downloads. this sets the stage for Here It Goes Again. Because again, the label doesn't believe in them. And they're like, you know what? This Dancing in the Backyard video did pretty okay. What can we do with like $300? And their answer was buy treadmills and choreograph a dance. So like what you're seeing is literally the lead singer's garage with a blanket hung up in the back and them just dancing in his garage on these treadmills. It took them 17 takes to get it perfectly. The previous video was the most downloaded video at 9 million views. This was the most watched video of all time for years with 53 million views. That is like how big of a gap this was from that one to the next.
Well, that's a pretty inspiring story. I've never heard a path like that before. It's from summer camp to they might be giants to major label to flop to inventing an app to you know, inventive choreography. It's an awesome, awesome story, you know, for sure.
And another fun fact that I just love about both of the dancing music videos is that it's actually the bassist lip syncing, because the vocalist struggled with doing the dance moves and lip syncing simultaneously, but the bassist could do it. So for years, everyone just thought that was the singer of the band, but it's not.
You couldn't tell me which one was which. I've never seen them play instruments.
No, me neither. That's what I said. The guy, bald guy with the glasses, I always assumed that he was like the lead singer and guitarist, but for all I know, that could be the drummer.
That's the bassist. Yeah. He's the bassist.
That's the bassist.
Oh, it is? Okay.
They need to wear name tags.
Yeah.
There's one other major piece to the puzzle that I want to talk about with OK Go, and it's post Here It Goes Again, which I think is equally fucking awesome. And like, you know, we talk about punk rock. This is, again, to me, is punk rock. So they put out their third album, and they have two fairly successful music videos with WTF and This Too Shall Pass. This Too Shall Pass is also kind of just known as the Rube Goldberg music video.
Amazing.
It's a fucking amazing music video.
So good.
Fans complained because they could only watch the video on YouTube. The record label at the time had it that you could not share YouTube links. You couldn't embed it. You couldn't do anything. And fans were getting annoyed because they couldn't post the video on Facebook or MySpace or anything. They just could send a link to someone to take somebody to the YouTube page. The lead singer of OK Go wrote a letter to the fans and was basically like, here's all the bullshit policies. This label doesn't understand how the internet works. It doesn't understand how things successfully go viral. Blah, 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 blah. I'm so sorry that you can't share this video. And then he secretly embedded code for them to be able to share on their pages in his open letter that he sent out to the fans, directly defying the record label's requests, which led to them getting dropped and them just starting their own indie label instead.
Wow.
Fucking legendary.
Like, yeah, I mean, by all accounts, this is one of the best backstories of a band that we've ever had on this podcast. And I think it's every step of the way this band carved their own path.
Yeah.
And, you know, with everything that in my life I've tried to do or whatever, I always felt that way. Like I was trying to carve my own path. And that is the ultimate success story to that. But why don't I listen to them? is the only thing I'm asking is, in preparation for this episode, I went and dug in all those music videos. And yeah, the Rube Goldberg one, amazing. The one with the dogs is amazing. There,
oh, yeah.
You could go down the rabbit hole of OK Go videos and your mind will be blown.
And you'll smile. I smiled all night last night watching these videos because they're just feel good. So the song This Too Shall Pass is the Rube Goldberg video, but they actually did two music videos. And the second one is them performing it live with a marching band in a field.
Oh, I love that one.
And like, I just had a big goofy smile on my face because it's just like, there's just four dudes playing marching drums and singing a song that they wrote and have a huge marching band like doing this giant elaborate performance behind them. And it's just like, you can see the joy on their faces that like they are absolutely 100% doing what they love.
Which one is your favorite music video?
It might be the Rube Goldberg one. I've watched that video so many times.
That one is impressive. But the treadmill, man, I think that Here It Goes Again, the one we're talking about today, I think that's the one that set the path and then gave them the resources. Because all the ones that followed, they still are that same concept of it's one shot video and it's very inventive. But I think they had a lot more money you know, to have other people involved. Like that Rube Goldberg device one, that was sponsored by State Farm. Like State Farm put up the money for that one. And that's going to lead me to something I want to talk about that might be unfair about OK Go and why maybe I don't listen to them. Even though I did add one of their songs today to my playlist, I'm going to try to start listening to them and get into them because I should like this band. In fact, I should love this band. Their story's amazing. Their songs are pretty catchy. And I'm like, why don't I love this? Why don't I? And Dave, you can speak to this. Do you listen to this band a good bit? Do you love this band? Do you just kind of think like, oh, this band is good? What is your, I want to know your backstory on OK Go.
I've definitely listened to every song at least once. And they are kind of, their hits are consistently in my rotation. Definitely think that I listen to the Oh No album the most, but even the one after that, The Blue Color of the Sky, I believe it's called, that one's got bangers on it too. I wouldn't say I know every song, but yeah, I've dabbled.
So here's my theory of why I don't listen to them. And OK Go, guys, if you're listening, you're super inspiring. Your band's really good. Your music videos are amazing. I would love to follow in your footsteps, but here's why I think I don't listen to them. What year is this song from, Matt? What year is Here It Goes Again?
So Here It Goes Again is 2006.
Okay. So then I saw that a lot of those other music videos, the Rube Goldberg, whatever, 2010 seemed to be a year that a lot of them came out.
Yeah.
And I think at that time, OK Go, I guess we would call them an indie rock band.
They juggled so many sounds. Every album sounds so different. Like the last album they put out in 2012 is basically an electronica album. Like it's all synthesizers.
So you're saying they're electronic as well. But okay, that aside, they're indie rock, but very polished at the same time, to the point where I feel like their music kind of is in this realm of a lot of songs that were used in commercials on TV during a certain era. Like, for example, I would think of this song in the same vein as, this is a song I really don't like, but in the same vein as that, I can make your hands clap, 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 clap. You know that song?
Oh,
I think
yeah.
Fits in the Tantrums, I think it is. Or like at a certain point, there were car commercials using like Phoenix songs and stuff in them. And once a song starts to get used in commercials on TV by big corporations, it really, for me, loses a lot of me wanting to listen to it. And that might be an unfair take.
I think that might be an unfair take. Because I think, so here's another thing. This is going to, I'm going to win you back, Chris. I'm going to win you back because I know you. They took a lot of corporation money to make these music videos. State Farm did the Rube Goldberg. They did an awesome Super Bowl commercial for Chevrolet called Needing Getting, which had over 47 million views. It's an awesome video.
That's my favorite.
Yeah, they were sponsored by Range Rover, Yahoo, Costco, Samsung, and Google Chrome. But here's something to win you over, Chris. Strap in. 2 days before Donald Trump was inaugurated as president, the band released a cover of Morrissey's song, Interesting Drug, and released a music video that was just a series of pictures and videos of Trump and people in his party while they repeated the lyrics, "There are some bad people on the rise." The video ends with the message, "It's a difficult time, but anger and fear aren't the answer. Work to make the world a better place," and then listed the ALU, the Climate Reality Project, the Immigration Defense Project, Planned Parenthood, and the Human Rights Project as suggested organizations that they think that their listeners should volunteer and donate to, and then pushed everyone to please, please vote in 2018, 2020. So while they do take corporate money, they also, I think, put their skill set to good use. In early 2020, the lead singer and his wife got COVID, and they, when he was done his recovery, wrote a song called All Together Now and filmed a video that was a tribute to the healthcare workers, and all of the proceeds from that song went to the Partners in Health project as well. So as much as, yes, they are taking these big corporate dollars to make these extremely polished music videos for their extremely polished sounding songs, they are also, I think, humanitarians. I think that there is a very strong chance that a band that's taking that much money from that many corporates would just stay neutral and try not to rock any boat. And I applaud them for being like, no, we're going to stand up for what we believe in because we have an audience that's listening to us.
Yeah, I mean, I think all you're proving here, Matt, is that I'm an asshole. I'm an asshole for not listening to OK Go because they are good. Like, the songs are really good. And on top of that, I play in a band who has polished recordings and would probably want to tour with them. And, like, it's very unfair of me who listens to nothing but polished music. Like, all of my unfair takes about them are based on, like, such bullshit that I realize when I'm wrong sometimes. Any preconceived notions I had about OK Go, which weren't necessarily bad, I thought the shit they did was cool as hell. I just questioned, why don't I listen to this band? That was my main question. Why don't I listen to them? And part of that could honestly be that, like, I've just been playing rock music for so long that at some point, like, it took something completely, like, out of left field for me to be interested in a polished, straight-up rock song. And that's just on me, you know? Yeah. So I think that's what it could be.
And obviously, you're one of my best friends, and you're in a band that's one of my favorite bands. I legit could hear Punchline being the band that wrote some of the OK Go songs. Like, yeah, they are so close in the same sound and genre and everything.
That could be my issue with them. They sound too much like my own band.
You're listening to it and you're like, I could have done that.
Yeah.
That could have been me. Right.
So I want to jump back to the reason why I got on the whole history of OK Go, and specifically the They Might Be Giants influence, was we were talking about the lyrics and what the meaning of Here It Goes Again is. And I think that the first verse, first of all, feels so much like some They Might Be Giants lyrics, which is, it could be 10, but then again, I can't remember a half an hour since a quarter to four, which is totally a They Might Be Giants type lyric.
Totally.
Yeah, it is.
Hi, this is Krista Makes, host of Krista Makes a Podcast. The theme of the podcast is songwriting. Each week, my musical guest picks a defining song from their career to discuss, critique, and analyze during the show. So please join me for some fun and insight into some of the greatest songs ever written and recorded. Listen and subscribe at soundtalentmedia.com.
Hey there, I am Johnny Christ from Avenged Sevenfold, and I've got a podcast called Drinks with Johnny you're going to want to check out. I sit down with a bunch of different people from all different walks of life, from professional wrestlers to actors, comedians, fighters, musicians, everything in between. I'm just looking to make some friends and have a good time doing it. So if that sounds like something you're into, go check out Drinks with Johnny, streaming everywhere now.
But then the second line of that verse that I love is, throw on your clothes, the second side of Surfer Rosa, and you leave me with your jaw on the floor. So Surfer Rosa is a famous Pixies album.
Yep. Pixies album.
So what's on the second side of Surfer Rosa?
You know, funny enough, it's actually the famous Pixies song, Where Is My Mind, Matt? Thank you for asking.
I think that says a lot about what you're saying with the song, where it's like, it's a song about falling in love with a one-night stand. And I think that there's a reason why he says the second side of Surfer Rosa is the idea of, like, falling in love with a one night stand. You're probably like, what am I fucking thinking? Like, yes. Where is my mind right now?
Are any of you guys any good at one night stands at all?
No. Never.
You know, I feel like I'm really putting myself out there, but I don't know if I've had one. Come on, Chris, you've had to have. No, I don't know. You know what? I always end up really, if I care enough to, like, hook up with somebody, I end up actually liking them. You know, like, that's, I don't know.
I had a brief period of one night stands in my life and I hated every second of it. It's not, yeah, it's not the lifestyle for me.
I just imagine Rough Road Matt just finding new women.
Yeah,
every night.
Every night. You can't hold that man down. What about you, Dave? What about you, Dave?
The Kelly's on the loose.
What's your experience with one night stands?
I've had a few one night stands and they are both in this song. I've had one that was like, it was somebody totally out of my league. I mean, them, it was charity work is really what they were doing for me. They should have got a tax credit, but left me completely, like, stunned. Then I started sleeping with one of my roommates one time, and now we're engaged.
Oh, wait, so that wasn't a one night stand. But are you saying at the time it was, and then later it became more? Okay.
And I was the one that caught feelings, which is exactly what this song's about.
Right.
It's about catching those feelings.
Right. I can relate to this. Like I said, any time in my life I was in that situation, it was like, I don't know if I'm just that romantic or whatever. I find it impressive when people can just bang and then be like, well, that was fun. I'm going to be on my way. I feel like there's something with me where, yeah, there has to be a certain amount of feelings for there to be attractiveness to want to. I mean, I feel like somebody at some point's gonna like call me out and go, Chris, you're full of shit. Don't you remember this? And I'm gonna be like, oh yeah, or what? But
don't you remember Warped Tour 2006?
I appreciate that you were in a band for 25 years touring Europe and America, and never once there was nothing that started out sleazy, something simple, something easy. That was just
I think there are things that maybe started out sleazy and then became my girlfriend, you know, like that's all I'm getting at. But my point being is these lyrics, that's what it's about. So, right. Is that what I'm getting here? Is like, yo, it's a one night stand, but then you catch feelings, right? Is that what's going on here?
Absolutely.
Yeah, cause then, you look at the second verse. It starts out easy, something simple, something sleazy, something inching past the edge of reserve. Now through the lines of the cheap Venetian blinds, your car is pulling off of the curb. But I get it. Like, it's like, okay, it starts off with like, hey, this is just like this like quick sleazy thing. Finger but now guns. I'm like looking out the window watching your car drive away like, oh, I wish you were staying.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think that's pretty cool. I wouldn't have guessed that that's what this song was about. I was too busy looking at the treadmills, which is a question I have for you guys. Maybe that's the problem. Maybe it's not the commercialization of, you know, the corporations and like hearing their music and their contemporaries in car commercials and stuff. Maybe it's that the music videos overshadow the music to the point where it's like, I'm not paying attention to the song. I'm just paying attention to the music video. Maybe
they're a distraction to the lyrics almost.
And I think that it's very easy to write off a song that has like this really flashy music video as just being just that. Like, it's just there for the clicks. It's just there for the views, and it's time to move on. It almost delegitimizes it a little bit. And I can understand that as well.
I mean, I'll bring up a video that I know Chris loves. But like, I've even heard someone make the argument, I think it was Rap Critic made the argument that like, as amazing as the song This Is America is, like, if you didn't have that music video and you were just listening to that song based on the music and the lyrics, would you have gotten what the message of the song was without that very in-your-face music video really showing like what was the deeper thing that Glover was trying to get to with that song? And it's an interesting question because you can't really answer it because everyone's first exposure was through that music video. So like the context of the song was like right there in front of you.
That example, that is a pretty, I always use this word, but the song itself is pretty avant-garde. It's like this hard hitting bass that shakes your car, and then the bass is completely taken away and it's like a party, and then the bass kicks back. Yeah, that song, it's a very unique song. I don't know any other songs that sound like that, but would I have gotten the commentary on the state of America from the song itself without the imagery of that music video? I don't know, minus the line, This Is America.
Yeah.
Okay Go is a completely different situation.
Completely different situation.
Because they're,
I think
just,
they're the same.
Honestly, yeah,
exactly,
they're just
the
trying
same
to make us happy.
Yeah. I mean, you know what? I look at them on treadmills and I think I should have a one-night stand.
So the guitarist, their lead guitarist, wasn't the original guitarist for the band. He showed up kind of after Oh No was recorded. And when he auditioned, they asked him if he was okay doing like choreographed dances in the band. And man, that yes went a long fucking way, didn't it?
Yeah, for sure. For sure. Yeah, I mean, imagine if he'd have said no. I mean, it's amazing how to this day people are spellbound by dancing. It's always, you know, and it makes me say like, man, maybe my band should have danced. maybe that should have been our thing. At one point we did do a very basic choreographed dance on national TV. I will say the punchline did do that at one point. You can barely call it a dance. It was more like a little jazz hands routine or something.
I don't know what it was.
I wish it involved more feet stuff. But dancing is not going away. What do we love about dancing so much?
I think that its dance is objectively impressive because everybody has a body and everybody can't dance.
Right.
So seeing somebody that can just like can do that, no matter how hard it is, it's everybody looks at that and goes, yep, I was not going to get up from the couch to try.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I think that that's a very huge thing for OK Go. And maybe the dancing is missing when I'm listening to just their music. I don't, their music is danceable. The main thing I'm taking away from this right now is I've released a lot of unfair takes about OK Go. The main thing I'm taking away from today is I am going to dive into OK Go moving forward. And what's ironic about this is every day I run on the treadmill. And today, when I run, I didn't run yet today. I usually have already run, but we've been recording podcasts. I'm going to run to OK Go on the treadmill today and see what that experience is like.
It's going to feel so right.
This album called Oh No that this song is on, is that right?
Yes.
That is what I'm going to listen to today. I can't wait to experience it. It could be interesting.
I mean, I'm going to tell you my two big recommendations. This Too Shall Pass, which, again, the Rube Goldberg music video. That song, as a standalone song, is an awesome song. And as I mentioned before, their very first single, Get Over It, I think that song's a fucking banger. And I'm still mad that song wasn't a huge hit.
I'm also going to recommend Needing/Getting, because I heard that song on the record before I watched the music video, and I fell in love with it with that first. So I know it stands up by itself.
Well, also, one more thing that we got to talk about before we end here. So we're calling this a one-hit wonder, even though they've obviously had a lot of very popular, viral music videos. But none of those other songs charted. Am I correct? When I say charted, this song peaked at number 38 on the Billboard Hot 100, and that is the highest any of their songs ever went, correct?
They only had one other song to even crack the top 100, and it was at like 79. And it's a song that I don't know by them.
Wow.
It was off their last album in 2012, so I think it may have been the first and only song of theirs that like had the connective tissue.
Of this song.
Yeah.
You know, when this song was number 38... the number one song was Sexy Back by Justin Timberlake, but there were some other songs in the charts at that time which were kind of in the same world in a way, like Move Along by All American Rejects was in there at number 28, a little bit above them. That song's kind of in the same world of polished pop rock song, as is I Write Sins Not Tragedies by Panic the Disco was up there, and also a song we covered on here recently, Crazy by Gnarls Barkley. So there was actually like some pretty cool rock-ish songs, rock pop-ish songs in the charts at that time. It's not like you're looking at these charts and it's like all Justin Timberlake-like stuff. You know, there was some rock in there. 2006, not a bad time for music when I look back at it.
Yeah, it was not terrible. I mean, one of the songs that you did skip over in my notes, because it's a god-awful song, but I think we're going to have to cover it one of these days, was Hinder, Lips of an Angel.
I don't even know that song.
Oh, it's a bad one.
Well, guys, I think I kind of feel like I know what everybody's already going to say. Did this song bring the one-hit thunder, or is it a one-hit blunder? The only caveat to this is, dude, this is almost a no-hit wonder. Peaking at number 38, like, that's a... I mean, I know we've done Pavement on here. We've done songs that were also in this range of, like, did they have a hit at all? Like, because we're talking about hits when you're talking about songs like Take On Me, and you're talking about these enormous... Even, like we just mentioned, even Gnarls Barkley Crazy, that was like a phenomenon of a song in 2006, whereas this was...
I think on the flip side, I do think it counts as a hit from the cultural standpoint of, like, similar to, like, a Gundam Style. Like, that music video has been parodied on everything. The Simpsons, so many cartoons have done their version of this where they're playing the song in the background while they're recreating the video. Like, it was the video was such a cultural phenomenon that they didn't even perform the song at the VMAs. They just did the treadmill dance at the VMAs. Like,
it's such a fun path for a band, and even it's almost like they're bigger than a band. They're just like a creative force in every aspect. Music, they'd probably be pissed if they heard me say this, but it feels like music isn't even the number one like thing they're best at. I think they're a really good band, and I'm going to find out how good of a, I'm going to dig in. I think they're a really good band, but I think that as entertainers in general, they might be even stronger. You know,
they ascended.
Yeah,
just entertainers.
And you know, to go back to the idea that they were getting corporate sponsorships for these music videos, like, really, can you blame either side of that? You know what I mean? Like, it's like, A, can you blame a band who just got dropped from their record label but has an opportunity to just continue to be a band because major companies want to sponsor their music videos? But then, like, the flip side is, like, can you blame a sponsorship that sees a band that so clearly understands how to make something a viral success and not pay them a bunch of money to, like, plaster your company's icon on their next project? Like,
yeah, I mean, this might be everything about them. They're a creative powerhouse. They carved their own path. They're still a band. They've done everything I could ever hope and dream to accomplish in the world of music and entertainment. They're amazing. Questionable whether this is considered a hit, but that aside, very, very, I don't know if petty is the right word of me, but yeah, Matt, of course it won me over that as a band, they spoke out against Trump. Like, of course, of course, when Trump is rising to power, I'm like, where's Bruno Mars? Where's Drake? Where's all these people that I like their music?
Where's Coolio? God damn it.
Yeah, all these people, even a lot of bands are like keeping their mouth shut because they probably are worried about losing fans. I so respect when a band would speak out against hate and things like, as a band, like, I love that. I can't help it. And I know that that should be separate from the sonic quality of the music and the melodies and the emotion of the songwriting. That should be a separate thing. But for me, it's hard to separate that. I mean, I'm just a person, you know, I'm taking the whole package in, and I think this is, I mean, I know I talked a little shit throughout this episode, but this band is absolutely one of the most thunderous bands that we've probably covered on this podcast, I would say.
I'm inclined to agree. I want to just real quickly reference a quote that I just happened to catch. In 2014, the lead singer was being interviewed by Rolling Stone, and they asked him, why did the band continue to make so many quirky videos following the success of Here It Goes Again? And he said that they were really worried that they would end up being a one-hit wonder, and they decided they could go in one of two directions. They could either try to outrun it like Radiohead did with Creep, or they could just embrace it, and they decided to just embrace it.
Fucking more power to them.
Like, I think that we've talked about that a million times before on this show. Like, you know what? I also love the bands that don't hate their hit. They get that they've been given a golden opportunity. They take that golden ticket and they go and do something with it. So, I mean, obviously I've been like the big fanboy of them since the second we hit record. So yeah, thunder from me. And I think, Dave, you gonna surprise us?
Absolutely thunderous over here. And and to piggyback off what you said there about when you get the thing that works, I think the best thing you can do is just lean into it hard. And they leaned into it, and they've had careers ever since.
Yeah, imagine if after this success of this music video and song, they would have made their next three music videos would have just been them, like, looking cute and playing their instruments. You know, like, that would have been probably the end of their career. But instead, they were like, oh, they probably made some money. You know, that's a lot of plays. They had some money to then take what they do to the next level. A better camera, hiring, you know, that Rube Goldberg device at the end of the video. They show all the people involved. There's a lot of people involved in that music video to make that thing happen. And yeah, they leaned into it. And yeah, that's awesome. It's really, really awesome. And I'm not even deep enough into their catalog to know, Matt, you said they got into more electronic elements. Maybe on the music side, I'm not saying they're Radiohead, but maybe on the music side, they did progress as well. Who's to say they didn't?
I think, so this jumped into my head when I watched the marching band video that they did for This Too Shall Pass, is like, that video, their bassist is playing a xylophone, their lead singer is playing a marching bass drum, their drummer is playing a marching snare and cymbal, and their lead guitarist is playing an accordion. And it made me kind of dig into, like, oh, this band is also like a bunch of multi-instrumentalist dudes who can like play multiple different sounds. So I think that as you get into those later records, it is them just expanding, like, hey, what else can we fucking play? Hey, you know how to play the synthesizer? Let's just load that shit up on this album. So I appreciate a band that feels like it's very connectively, like, four dudes who clearly love each other, who clearly love creating music with each other, and, like, pushing each other creatively, both visually and musically. So, I mean, this is not just me trying to kiss up to you, Chris. I do see a lot of similarities with this band, and when I, like, hang out with Punchline and see how it's, like, the four of you guys clearly care about each other and like to push each other musically to like expand the sound.
These guys look like they're having fun in the stuff they're doing. And honestly, anything you do creatively, if it's not fun, then why are you doing it?
Yep.
You know, if you're doing it to like try to get rich or something, you're doing it for the wrong reasons. It seems like, you know, the clever lyrics of this song and everything they do is great. And speaking of creating things, Dave, at the beginning of the episode, I mentioned that you host a podcast called Maximum Mediocrity. Would you please let the listeners know what the podcast is all about?
Absolutely. I make the Maximum Mediocrity podcast with my friend and co-host Morgan, where we interview people that aren't famous but should be. And honestly, OK Go fits into that so well.
Yeah, I was just going
to
say that.
I would love to have them if they ever want to come on the show. But yeah, that's what we do. We interview people that choose like skill and interesting stories over their own fame. And usually we get them pretty trash and get all the juicy, gory details out of them.
Nice. Dude, you couldn't have picked a better song / band to relate to your own podcast than OK Go. Yeah, dude, that'd be the perfect example. It's like, this band, you know them by the routines, the videos, whatever, but as individual people, do any of us know any of their names?
I had to write them down. I did not.
Well, no, you didn't know their names. Nobody knows their names.
No one does.
For all I know, one guy is O, one guy is K, one guy is G, one guy is O again. They're as a collective, they are a well-known force, but as individuals, yeah. I feel like any of them could be a guest on what you described your podcast to be as creative people that should be household names is what I'm probably getting at.
Yeah, absolutely. It's people that should be more famous than they are. And
right.
That actually had me thinking, I'm looking at the drummer for OK Go, and like, he'd probably do an interview.
Yeah, I
can snipe that.
I guarantee you these guys, if we reached out to them, that like at least three out of four of them would probably do it. But thanks for coming on today, Dave.
Hey, thank you so much for having me. This was so much fun to do. Even before we hit record, I was having so much fun doing the research. So thank you so much for having me. This was amazing.
The best time.
This has been One Hit Thunder. One Hit Thunder is hosted by Chris Sefalios of the bands Punchline, Pack, and Another Cheetah, and produced by Matt Kelly of Geekscape.net. Underneath me, you're hearing Greatest Party Ever off the Punchline album Delightfully Pleased. Visit punchline.com for information on future shows, releases, and merchandise. And we're on Patreon now. Visit us at patreon.com/OHT podcast for bonus material, early access to episodes, and a chance to help decide what songs we discuss in future episodes. Do you want to hear your song on the show or have an interest in sponsoring an episode? Contact me at matt@geekscape.net for our rates. If you have any interest in podcasting, visit weknowpodcasting.com for how Matt and Chris can make your show sound as professional as possible, and let us know your thoughts on the show by emailing us at onehitthunderpodcast@gmail.com. Make sure to rate, review, and subscribe to us on your favorite podcasting app. Tune in next week for another episode of One Hit Thunder. It's always New Year's Eve of 2000 something. Ow.
the Geekscape Network.
What's up, everybody? I am Finn McKenty, host of the Punk Rock NBA podcast, part of the Sound Talent Media podcast network. My podcast is all about doing what you love for a living, and every week I sit down and talk to people who have done exactly that. For example, musicians like Tommy from Between the Buried and Me, Matt from Periphery, Lil Lotus and Shinigami, among many others, photographers, artists, designers, YouTubers like Glenn Fricker and Sarah Dici, and I unpack exactly how they got to where they are today with the goal of helping you do the same. So if that sounds cool, you can listen and subscribe at soundtalentmedia.com, and I'll see you there.
Hi, podcast listeners. I'm Carol Costello, a former CNN anchor and national correspondent. This January, I'm launching a podcast about one of the first cases I ever covered as a journalist. It's one that stuck with me all of these years, the one that buried itself under my skin and stayed put. It's a true crime series about an amazing woman named Phyllis Cottle, who defied torture and death and brought a fierce rage to the quest to find her attacker. Carol Costello Presents Blind Rage is a production of Evergreen Podcasts and signature title of the Killer Podcast Network. Listen and subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. Discover more great true crime and paranormal programming at killerpodcast.com.